Next up, we are having cross-site scripting. You must have heard about this term, cross-site scripting or cross-site request forgery. It is one of the most crucial attacks, and it is even listed in the OWASP top 10 vulnerabilities on a website. So a cross-site scripting attack is basically, again, a type of injection attack in which the malicious scripts are injected into otherwise benign and trusted websites. In short, XSS attacks occur when an attacker uses a web application to send malicious code, generally in the form of a browser side script, to a different end user. The flaws that allow these attacks to succeed are quite widespread and occur anywhere a web application uses inputs from a user. Within the input, it generates without validating or encoding it. An attacker can use the XSS to send a malicious script to an unsuspecting user. Hence, we can say that this sort of attack is very difficult to trace. But once if it is traced down, it should be plugged so that no such attack can take place in the future. Hello students, welcome back. I hope you all are doing great. In this video, we are going to learn about cross-site scripting. We are going to see what exactly is cross-site scripting, how does it work, what are its various types, and then we will perform experiments based on cross-site scripting. Just make a point over here that we are not going to target real-life applications, or we are not going to target real-life websites, because doing so would be a crime, and I don't want either you or me behind the bars for performing this experiment. So we will be using certain local host applications using which we can simulate the entire cross-site scripting attack using only a local host machine without actually interacting with a real-life website. So for that, what do we need exactly is, we need a software called as DVWA. It is basically an acronym for DAM Vulnerable Web Application. So we are going to need this particular tool, DVWA. Along with that, we need to set up a local host, and we know how to set up a local host with the help of applications such as XAMPP or WAMP. I will show you how to install XAMPP or WAMP, then how to download this particular tool DVWA. And once you install this tool DVWA on your local host, it will create an environment for you where you can actually perform your attacks and see how the web server reacts to your attacks. We are going to actually launch attacks on a local web host, local web server, and we will be able to carry out cross-site scripting attacks on that particular local host. So without wasting much time, let me show you how to install XAMPP or WAMP. The very first thing is you need to type in XAMPP over here in your browser, and the very first link, apachefriends.com. This is the link from where apachefriends.org. This is the link from where you can download XAMPP. It's available for Windows, it's available for Linux, it's also available for OS X. So depending upon your processor, you can download any of these installers and install it in your machine. It's a very simple, straightforward installation. You don't need to select any tools, any services. You can simply click on next, 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 and the installation will be complete. Once you are done with the installation, the thing you need to execute is, simply go to your search bar and type XAMPP, XAMPP, and you will be able to see this icon. Open that, and this is how the XAMPP control panel will look like. If everything went smoothly, then you would be able to run these services without any error or without any problem. Otherwise, if you see some errors over here, depending upon that particular error, you need to troubleshoot your error. For example, sometimes there might be clashing port numbers. For example, port 80 might be used by some other processes. For example, applications such as Skype, Hangout, etc., they might be using port 80. So you need to close those ports for those applications temporarily, and then you would be able to run this application on port 80. So what we are exactly doing is, we are creating a local host using Apache server, and we are making use of local databases using MySQL. XAMPP stands for cross-platform Apache, MySQL, Perl, and PHP, right? So this is how the application looks like. Similarly, there is one more application called WAMP, which is primarily built for Windows. But I'm more comfortable with XAMPP, so I preferably use XAMPP, right? So once you have set up this application, once you have set up your server, what happens now is you are now in a position to run any web application locally on your machine. So if you are a web designer or if you are designing websites for any client, then you should have this XAMPP or WAMP on your machine so that before actually working on the live host, you can experiment on a local host and then migrate your applications on the live host. This is actually what we do, right? This is the correct way or correct practice of doing it without hampering the live host, right? So now let's get back to our main topic of attention over here, that is cross-site scripting. So what we need to do right now is, after installing XAMPP, we need to go back and install DVWA. So click on it. And this is how the DVWA website looks like. It's very simple. You simply need to scroll down, click on download. First, read it. It is a web application based on PHP MySQL, which is primarily designed for performing attacks. So it is basically like it is helping the security professionals or web application designers to come and try this particular application so that they would be able to learn how attacks work. They would be able to learn how the systems react to those attacks and so on. Simply click on download, and it is approximately 1.3 MB in size. So go to that location and extract all the contents somewhere temporarily. For example, over here only, or you can move it to desktop. Give it a name, DVWA for example. And click on extract. Yeah, so this is the file which is extracted. Go inside it, and what you can do is you can copy this particular folder. Go to your C drive, where actually XAMPP is installed by default. So wherever you have installed your XAMPP, go to that location. In my case, I have installed it on Windows C drive. So this is where XAMPP is. So go inside that XAMPP folder. There will be a folder called htdocs. Htdocs is the actual root folder where your website's data resides. So you click on it. And you will see that these are the various websites that I have created. So each and every folder is nothing but one website. So now what you can do is, whatever folder you had copied, paste it over here and just get rid of this master. Fine. So this is your DVWA folder. This is your localhost's root folder for DVWA. Now, how to access your website? It's very simple. Now what you need to do in step number four is you have to open your website in your browser. So for that, go to this control panel and you can click on admin over here, Apache admin. And once you click on it, this is the directory of all the websites that you are having on your local host. Fine. Now you need to go inside DVWA. So click on DVWA, and this is how the website looks like. Obviously, it is having some errors and we need to solve it. So it's very simple. Just follow the step-by-step guidelines and you will be able to solve this error. What is this error? Just go back to the cheat sheet. I knew that you will be facing errors. In fact, I also faced error for the very first time. So what we need to do is open the website through a browser that we have done. Next step is you will encounter an error such like this. Config file not found. So what you can do is go to the config folder, that is wherever DVWA is, go inside that folder, that is config folder, and you will encounter a file over here, config.inc.php.dist. What you need to do is simply follow this step. Change the extension of the file, remove the .dist from the extension. That is what you need to do. You simply need to rename this instead of this dist, just end it on PHP, and that's it. Now simply go back to your browser and reload this page. Now this is how DVWA will look like. Obviously it is password protected, but where is the password? Again, it's very simple. Everything is given to you having some different credential. For example, let me try admin and admin. Yes, and this worked out. So the default credentials, instead of admin and password, they are admin and admin. So you just make some changes over here. It is, instead of admin and password, it should be admin and admin for the latest version of DVWA. Fine. Next, step number 10 is go to the setup and reset databases. Now just make sure that whenever you're running this particular application for the very first time, you need to create your own set of databases. I will show you how to set up your database. So just see on the left hand side, there are a few options: home, instructions, setup, reset database. So click on setup / reset database and just scroll down, click on create reset databases. Now if everything is smooth, it will be set up successfully. As you can see, database has been created, users table was created, etc., etc. Just go back. In case if it shows an error, you have to make changes in the database file accordingly. Now let me show you. If you are running this for the very first time, you might have some errors. So let me show you how to deal with those errors. Simply go back to your config file over here. Just right click on it and open it in either Notepad or any other text editor. When you scroll down over here, you will see that this is your database name, this is your username, and this is your password. So in short, you have to create a database with this username, with this database name, and this password. That is why in my case, I already have a database of these credentials. That is the reason I didn't encounter any error. In your case, if you don't have any of these values, then it will cause an error. So how to resolve it? It's very simple. You simply need to go to phpMyAdmin, that is, open your XAMPP control panel, go to the admin panel of MySQL. So click on it and you will be redirected to this database tab. Over here, you can see that I already have this DVWA database with me. So if I go to the user accounts, I will see that I already have one user with DBWA, host name is localhost, and it has got some password, and this password is nothing but this password only. That is why I didn't encounter any errors. In your case, you need to create an user. So simply go to add user account. Give it a username. You can either keep these values or you can even have your own name over there. Just make sure that whatever name you have in this config file, that same should be highlighted inside your database also. So you can give a name over here, keep host as it is, give a password. Remember, that password should coincide with this password. Fine. And rest everything you can simply select, check all. Create database, it is not needed. Database for user account, it is not needed. Just click on check all and click on go, and you will be having your database in front of you. So right now I'm having this database DVWA. It is having these two tables. As you can see, users table was created, guest book table was created, and these are those two tables. Fine. So I hope this is clear how to resolve that error in case if you don't have any database created. Fine. Once you solve all these problems, your setup will be successful. So we have reached this step number 12 so far. So these are the prerequisites for setting up DVWA on your local machine. Now we will be starting with our actual experimentation. That is, we will be following our cheat sheet over here one by one. So in short, you can say that we have created a website on which we are going to now perform cross-site scripting. And remember, these all websites, and remember all these attacks that we are going to perform, you should restrict yourself to this application only. And you should not try this on any real life application or website. So just have a look at this XSS explanation once again. just have a look at this diagram. What exactly happens over here is, suppose there is a visitor who visits a website. Suppose there is this particular victim who is actually visiting a website over here. The user is visiting this website, logging using his or her credentials. Some sensitive data will be stored. Some sensitive data will be exchanged between that particular visitor of that web page and that website. Now what happens if there is an attacker and this attacker somehow injects some malicious code or malicious script onto this website, this real website? Then what happens is, whenever this particular victim or whenever this particular visitor visits that website, this corresponding script that you see over here will keep on executing every single time. And as a result, what will happen, whatever sensitive information this particular visitor or this particular victim is sharing with this website, all those informations will be captured and provided to this attacker. This is what we call in simple essence as cross-site scripting. And that is what we are going to perform today. They are of three types. First one is reflected, second one is stored, and third one is DOM. So reflected accesses is the simplest of all those accesses types. As you can see, reflected accesses is nothing but you can see the scripts on top of that URL bar. So all those malicious scripts or all those cross-site scripting intended scripts are actually mentioned in the URL of that website. You can see it carefully. That is what we call as reflected. It goes from one end to the other end. It completes its task and those results are fetched and sent back in the URL itself. That is what we call as reflected type of accesses. It comes from an HTTP request. Next one is stored accesses. Stored accesses is a sophisticated type of accesses in which the victim communicates with that website's database, stores that malicious script inside that database for a very long period of time. So in short, what happens, whichever script that the attacker has created that will interact with the website's source code, and it will stay over there for a long amount of time. And that is why it is also called as a persistent accesses. It is going to stay there for a long amount of time, and its result or its response comes from the website's database. So you can't see the output of this particular attack on the URL. Everything that you will be able to see is on that website itself. So it basically interacts with the database, fetches the result from the database, and then displays it on the screen. Fine. Third type is DOM-based. The third type is DOM-based accesses. As we all know, XML documents are stored in a tree-like structure. So all those websites which actually store the data in a tree-like structure may have some sort of a vulnerability. The attacker exploits this vulnerability and tries to interact directly with the source code so that the attacker basically modifies the entire structure in which the data is stored. As a result, whatever malicious script the attacker sends to that server or that website, that modifies the entire structure in which the data is stored. And as a result, the victim, whenever opens that particular website or whenever the victim visits that particular website, he or she will get some results in a totally unexpected manner. And as a result, that particular victim may end up giving some vital or crucial information to the attacker without even knowing that he or she is passing some information to the attacker. So this is the most difficult type of cross-site scripting attacks, and we are going to restrict ourselves to the first and second type of cross-site scripting for our experimental purpose. So we are now going to start with the very first type, that is reflected accesses. So how to perform reflected accesses? Let's just go back to the damn vulnerable web application interface. As you can see over here, there are n number of attacks mentioned over here. So we are, for the time being, restricting ourselves to accesses reflected and accesses stored. In the future, we can also try to perform attacks such as these: brute force, command injection, CSRF, that is cross-site request forgery, etc., etc. So as you can see, this particular application is very handy and you can use it to practice and launch attacks of various types on a local host running in your home PC. So let's get started with our very first task, that is cross-site scripting reflected. But before that, this particular application has got four levels of security. If I go to DVWA security, you will see that there are four levels of security, and by default, the security level is currently set at impossible. So obviously, whatever methods or mechanisms are used to break into it, I won't be able to do it because it's already set at the impossible level. So for our purpose, for our experiment purpose, we are going to set it to low first, low, medium, and high. And we are going to try with all these three levels of security, low, medium, and high. For the time being, let us set this to low and click on submit. As you can see, low level security is completely vulnerable and has no security measures at all. Its use is to be as an example of how web application vulnerabilities manifest through bad coding practices. We will see how some bad coding practices will end up opening up doors to the attacker for an easy access to your system. So let's see how we can implement this. Let's get back to our cheat sheet. Step 1. Change the security level to low, that we have already done. Try some basic HTML and scripts. For this, let's go back to XSS Reflected. Now, assume that this is a text box and you have to perform your attack on this text box. Now, what to do? Now, refer your cheat sheet. Try some basic HTML and scripts. Simply copy this. Go back and paste it over here and check how it responds. If I press submit, as you can see, I had simply entered an HTML statement over here, that is H1 hello world, and its output is shown like this. So what exactly is happening? Can anyone of you tell me? This is basically a vulnerability present in the code or the source code. How? I am actually sending an HTML statement over here. So ideally, what the server should do is, the server should strip these off and only focus on this text. But what it is doing is, it is converting this entire statement as an HTML statement, and it is rendering that HTML statement and displaying me the result. That should not happen. Otherwise, what an attacker can do is, an attacker can simply send any malicious script over here, and that will be executed as it is in the back end, and that will be shown to the victim on his or her screen, right? So that should not happen. If I'm sending some HTML statements, these tags should be stripped off and only this text should be displayed. Fine. Now what it is doing is, it is exactly converting my text into a heading tag. As you can see, its size is bigger. So it is converting that into a heading tag and then displaying the result as hello world. Am I making sense? Right. So next, try with this one. Let me copy this and paste it over here. And let's submit. As you can see, the code was like this. Font color blue and my name, and again the font is closed. So as you can see, only my name is displayed in blue, rest everything is in red. Fine. So you will see the source code. This hello was already present, and after that, whatever is displayed, this is coming from this text box. So now what is happening, whatever I'm entering over here, the same formatting is maintained. That should not happen, because the attacker can exploit the situation and send a malicious code. Simply check the third one. Here comes the main risk. That is, I can run a script on the victim's machine by simply pasting it over here, pressing submit, and as you can see, a dialog box pops up. So just imagine you're working on a website and suddenly a dialog box or pop-up box pops up, alert box pops up. It is very annoying, right? But just imagine if you click on that dialog box and the malicious software gets downloaded on your machine. Not only it is annoying, but it is dangerous for your system as well. So this is what can happen if you have cross-site scripting vulnerabilities present on your website. Is it clear? So what is the remedy? Whenever you are designing a website, whenever you're designing a source code, just make sure that you are sanitizing the inputs properly. You should not read these contents as it is. You should strip these keywords from the text and only process the text as it is. But over here, we are processing it along with the tags also, and that is why the backend is rendering them as HTML statements or script statements and executing them as it is. That is where the vulnerability creeps in. Let me show you the fourth type. It is what we call as a cookie or cookie redirection. Let me paste it. What should be the output? The output should display the cookie, the current session cookie on top, as you can see. Security is low, and these are the cookie values, and this is nothing but the session ID. So you can just imagine how crucial this is. You can simply copy this session ID and perform a session redirection or session hijacking attack without any problems. Isn't it cool? So this is what happens in the low level security. So let me show you the source code, and then you will come to know what exactly is happening over here. Just have a look at this source code. What is it doing? It is simply displaying hello, and whatever input it is getting from the URL, it is displaying as it is. So whatever I am entering on the, so whatever I'm typing and submitting through that text box, it is fetched as it is without any changes, and it is getting displayed over here. This is the main cause of concern over here, because it is not doing any sort of stripping, any sort of sanitization, input sanitization, and that is what leads to the problem. So you need to be ensure that your website is properly sanitizing the inputs before sending them to the database. So you should ensure that your website, your source code is properly sanitizing the inputs before sending them to the backend. Otherwise, this sort of a vulnerability may creep in. Fine. So this was all about the low level security. Next up, let's move on towards the medium level security. So again, go to your setup reset database and reset your database once before moving on to the next security level. Fine. So now let's go to DBWA security. From low, switch it to medium and click on submit. Now, in case of medium, what happens is it is also having some bad security practices, but it is still having certain improvements over the low level security. We'll see how they are different. Let's get back to XSS Reflected and let's try with some piece of code. Again, let's try with some basic piece of code. Let me copy this alert script. Let me go and paste it over here. Click on submit. Now, isn't it somewhat different? Yes, it is different. What is it doing exactly? As you can see, the script tags are stripped off, and the only thing that is displayed on the screen is alert XSS. Hello was already present. So it is displaying only the text contained within those script tags. So as a result, some sort of input sanitization is taking place. It is stripping off these keywords or these tags and displaying only this much part. Otherwise, in the previous case, what happened? It actually popped up a message called XSS using a dialog box. That is not happening over here. So here we can see a striking difference in terms of security over here. Let me try this one again, and I should not get the cookie value this time, right? Let me go and paste it. As you can see, I cannot see the cookie value over here. I can only see whatever was present inside those tags. Now, how is it happening? And in short, why is it happening? Well, there might be some sort of changes in the source code. Let's see that. As you can see, there is a new line added over here. If you see carefully, what it is doing is it is basically performing some sort of string operation. That is, wherever there is a script tag, it is replacing that script tag with a space. Is it making sense? So wherever there was a script tag, it was getting replaced by a space. So let me copy it once again and let me show it to you. If I go back over here and if I paste this, now what it is doing is whenever this data is sent to the database, instead of this script tag, it is replacing it with a space. Similarly, over here, this script tag is also getting replaced with a space. And then if I press submit, this is what is being displayed. Is it making sense? So at least there is some sort of a improvement in this particular piece of code. But again, this is not foolproof. We have to see how this can be made foolproof. And from an attacker's point of view, let's see how to break this security level. We can break this by simply camel casing our script. Camel casing as in lowercase, uppercase, alternate arrangement. So as you can see, the script is now written as a camel cased script. Lower, upper, and so on. Let me copy this and go back over here and paste it over here. Now we should see a dialog box. Yes or no? Yes. Why? Because we have now broken the security of medium level as well. So obviously medium level security was a little improvement over the low level security, but still it is having few vulnerabilities which can be exploited. So now let's move on towards the third level of security, that is high level of security. Again, disable or reset your database. Go back to DVW security and switch on to high security and press submit. Basically, the high level securities are generally found in all those capture the flag competitions where some case studies are sent out to the participants and they try to break into the systems. So these are comparatively high security standards, but still they can be broken. Let's see how to do it. Let's go to excesses reflected. Now what we need to do is you simply need to go to your cheat sheet and try the same scripts that you have been doing so far. Obviously, this is not going to work out, yes or no, because we have seen that in the case of low level as well as in medium level, there was a huge improvement in terms of security. So obviously, this is not going to work. And now what you can see is it is not even displaying the text present inside these tags. It is simply displaying some angle brackets over here. Now, what is it happening over here? It is not even displaying the result. How to break this then? Let's try with something else. Let me try this. Copy, go back, paste, submit. Again, this is not working out. So it is indeed a high level security. Let's try to do something else. Let's try to check the source code. View the source. As you can see, it is making use of some regular expressions. Now, what is it doing? What exactly is happening inside these regular expressions? As you can see, this regular expression is converting each open bracket, that is each open angular bracket, each script, whether it is in lowercase or in uppercase, it is using a wildcard over here. It will convert all of these occurrences into a space. So why are we getting a closing bracket or a closing angular bracket on the screen? Because that closing angular bracket is not part of this regular expressions. So what is happening? That opening angular bracket is converted to a space. Each and every corresponding script occurrence is converted to a space. But at the end, there is one closing tag as well. So that closing tag is not getting converted and it is reflected as it is. And that is what is being shown on the screen. So each and every character apart from this is getting converted to a space and only this much is displayed on the screen. So it is a very beautiful sort of input sanitization happening over here. And as a result, you are only able to see this and nothing else. I hope this is clear. Fine. So let's try out some pure HTML tags and try to break it, because as we saw in the script, it is only considering the script tags. It is only considering the script tags and it is not considering or it is not trying to block any HTML or pure HTML strings over here. So let's try to break it by feeding some pure HTML strings over here and let's hope we can break it. So let's use this particular piece of code. Let me copy it and paste it over here. As you can see, this is an image tag, so it should not get blocked by the source code, and we will still be able to find out the document cookie. As you can see, image source is having no source at all, and if there is no source, it should prompt this error in form of an alert. So as a result, by this way or the other way, I am trying to find out the document cookie. If it is not getting done with the help of script tags, I am trying to do it with the help of other pure HTML tags, in this case an image tag. So let's go back and press submit, and as you can see, we are getting the same results. So as a result, we are able to break into the high level security as well by bypassing it with some pure HTML comments or pure HTML source code. I hope this is clear. Let's try the same thing with the help of a pure HTML body tag. Again, copy it, and every time whenever the web page loads, it will display me the document.cookie. So let's get back over here. Let's paste it, submit. As you can see, this is happening, right? Each and every time whenever I'm loading the web page, this particular script will pop up and it will show me the session cookie. So this is very annoying. So just imagine if you insert this piece of malicious script onto a website, whenever the website is reloaded, this particular thing will pop up and your session cookie, session variables will be stored somewhere and sent to the attacker. So this is how cross-site scripting is done. We have completed the cross-site scripting reflected type. Now let's go back to the stored type. It's almost similar, but you will see the differences between stored and reflected. So let's start with the stored type of cross-site scripting. As you can see it over here, in this case, we are having two text boxes instead of one. So we need to find out which of these text boxes is vulnerable in nature. How to do it? Well, it's again very simple. Whatever commands you have seen so far, you have to again try and implement those commands over here as well. But before that, if you have forgotten to set up the databases, again reset the database once again. Go back to the DBW security and don't forget to keep it on low initially. Fine. So let's go back to the XSS stored. Now this time, again try out with the basic HTML scripts and tags. So let me copy this hello world, go over here and paste it. As you can see, the size of this text box is not that huge, so we can enter some limited characters only. Well, how to go ahead? How to break this then? Because we won't be able to enter our scripts over here, yes or no? So what we can do is, either we can make use of this or we can make use of this and then try to sign in. As you can see, hello was already present over there and then the message. So I can make use of either this text box or this text box. It is giving me the same result. I am able to bypass the security and the message is getting displayed over here. Fine. Similarly, if I would like to see whether I can play around with the size of this text box, that is also possible. Obviously, you can't directly interact with the backend, you can't directly interact with the source code, but what you can do is you can click on inspect element and try to find out the maximum length column over here. Yeah, instead of max length as 10, you can make it as 100 and then press enter. Now you will be able to put your entire code over here. Just make sure that you don't close this inspect element and then click on sign guestbook. Yeah, the message needs to be full. The message cannot be empty, so you can type any value over here, for example your name, and then press sign guestbook. And as a result, you see your message is displayed and your code is executed properly. So this is how you can keep on playing around with the text box size as well. Just make sure inspect element is clicked on and it is not closed. Fine. So this is our very first bypass mechanism. I'm not going to focus on each and every type because we know that we can easily bypass this particular low level security. So let's go and check the source code for this. How is it different from the previous case? Oh, this is huge. So as you can see, as you can see, how is it different from the reflected XSS? You can see this is what happens over here. It is trying to do something, some sort of input sanitization. It is strip slashing. What do you mean by strip slashing? It is basically removing some spaces. It is removing some extra characters from your input. But still, it is not in a position to check whether I am sending some sort of scripts, I am sending some sort of malicious inputs or not. It is simply escaping the characters. It is simply removing some spaces. It is removing some extra characters from the end of the string, but it is not removing any script tags, or it is not removing any tags from my command. It is not removing any tags from my text. So this is the basic level of security that it is doing. But still, it needs a lot of improvement. How to do it? It's again simple. Let's go back to the next level of security, that is medium security. Again, reset your database. Don't forget to do that. Go back to DBWS security. From low, switch to medium. And then go back to accesses stored. Now let's try to do the same thing over here. Now let's try with the next piece of code. Let's try to display a dialog box or an alert box. So let me copy this and go back here and let me paste this in both of these text boxes and press sign guestbook. As a result, as you can see, the alert box is not displayed. Rather, it is being replaced by something like this. Again, why this is happening? Let's go back to the source code and check it. So what exactly is happening over here is, we can see that in this piece of code, focus upon this and this. What is happening over here is, before actually sending the data to the database, some sort of sanitization is happening. What is that sanitization? As you can see, there is a variable message and there is a variable name. So those are, first of all, getting stripped by adding some slashes in between. So slashes, what do you mean by slashes? As you can see over here in the output, alert slash XSS slash so and so. Your code was something like this. Your command was something like this. So what exactly is happening over here is, first of all, the script tags are totally getting replaced by spaces. And second, whenever there are some special characters, they are getting replaced by some slashes. So slash in front of it. And again, if I encounter a special character, for example, double quotes, again, a slash is put in front of it. So this is what is happening in this piece of code, as you can see. So we are, first of all, stripping the tags. That is, all those opening and closing tags are stripped off. Then we are adding slashes in between the characters. Same thing is happening in the input section also. We are replacing the script tag with a space. And whenever there is any special character being used, they are getting replaced by slashes. So this is how this particular medium level security is working for the stored XSS. Well, how to break it then? There should be a way to break this also. There is. Again, as you can see in the source code, it is not considering the camel casing at all. So we can simply break it by changing the format of that script tag to somewhat like this. It is again very simple, the same technique. So simply paste it over here. We are doing some sort of camel casing, and let's click on this sign guestbook. Do we get the result? Let's check. We don't get the result. Well, why? It's very simple. Simply go back to the source code and check it once again. Yeah. The source code is like this. If you see, the message input is replacing the tags and adding slashes, but the name input is simply replacing the script, this piece of script, with spaces. So we should be interested in the name input field and not the message input field. Why? Because the message input field is not considering the script tag. It is simply stripping each and every tags it encounters. So even if we do camel casing, then also this particular message input tag will sanitize those. But that sanitization is missing in input field. As you can see, it is simply considering the script tag in this case, in this format, and replacing them and replacing those with a space. But if I do camel casing over here, this will fail miserably. So I need to target the name input field over here and not the message input field. So what I can do, I can simply type anything, for example, my name, and again do the inspect element thing over here. First of all, change it from 10 to 100 and try to insert the code over here, and now press enter. Yes, this is working. So this is how we can bypass the medium level security also. So we have to keep a close look on the source code, understand it thoroughly, and then we will be able to bypass all those security levels. So this is how we can protect ourselves. Now we are talking from both aspects. We are going through the source code and we are trying to find out the vulnerabilities. So now, as we know that this script tag is failing miserably over here, we can replace it with the next level security. That is, we can replace it with regular expressions that we are going to see in the high level security. So let's get back to the high level security. But before that, again, refresh your database. Go back to DBW security and now keep it high. So last level of security we are going to look into, that is DBWA security for accesses stored. Again, last thing over here, try the different scripts. Obviously, point number 3 and point number 4 is not going to work. What we can do is, let's try once if it is working or not. Copy it, go back over here. Let's try to inspect the elements. Again, change the size to 100. Type in the value, hi, and press this button. Nothing is working. As expected, it has been replaced with this closing bracket. Again, we have to go through the source code and we will see that it is making use of some regular expressions as usual. So it is making use of regular expressions. So we can't bypass this by simply camel casing. We need something else. In the previous case also, we saw that we can break it with the help of pure HTML statements. That is what we are going to do over here as well. So copy this statement, copy this code, go back, inspect element, make it 100, paste the piece of code over here, and you can type your name over here and press on this button. And as you can see, you have easily bypassed the high level security as well. So it is like you can bypass any security level provided you have a knowledge of the source code. So that is what happens in real life also. The source codes are analyzed properly, and if they are found to be vulnerable, then attacks such as these can be launched. Now, obviously, in real life, you don't have access to the source codes. So the attackers will keep on trying all these combinations one by one until they break into the system. That is what we call as brute forcing, right? So this is how cross-site scripting is actually performed on real life websites. Attackers keep on trying n number of combinations, and at the same time, the website developers also keep on trying to win against the attackers by constantly improving their source code. So there is a constant fight, there is a constant race between the attacker and the website developer. So this is very beautiful to look at, because at the end, no one is willing to lose, and both of them will ultimately keep on improving themselves. So this is the beauty of information security. One is trying to break it, the other is trying to protect it. So I hope you understood what is cross-site scripting and how we can perform it using this application called DVWA. I will be sharing the PDFs, the cheat sheets, and the links from where you can download this particular tool. So stay tuned for the upcoming videos. God bless you. Take care.